So good afternoon, everyone. Would like to thank the organizers for ensuring I'm not the last person to speak. So sorry, Philip, but I think I just missed that one. And I think the more important session is the next one, which is lunch. So I shall keep it short and keep my speech, so to say, a bit more on our experience at the exchange and our interaction with educational institutions, both as a potential employer as well as an exchange trying to provide financial literacy to India. Having said that, I did prepare a few notes over the last 2 days out of the 40% of the time that I may have been in office actually working. So I will compulsorily impose some of that on you here. So NSE, yes, is India's largest exchange. Globally, we hold a fair amount of rankings as well in terms of trades. More importantly, we enter our 25th year next year. And as Mr. Srinivasan rightly said, we have seen the landscape change significantly in phases. So in 1994 was the time when NSE came, and with NSE came electronic trading, making the parties anonymous. You could see the transparency in prices, speed, et cetera, and the open outcry was gone. In 1996, within 1.5 to 2 years, we had supremacy in the Indian markets. So while products have come over the entire journey of 25 years, technology, of course, has changed from very nascent technology to now more advanced technologies like AI, machine learning, whatever you call it. It's all there. It's all happening. We see it on a daily basis. And as mentioned as well, I think about almost 15, 20 years back, hardly 2 to 3% of the trades were resulting from algorithmic trading. Now, the trades that actually happen are 50%. The orders that are put in the system are a lot more from complex algos. And there are, of course, now high-frequency traders as well. With trades happening in nanoseconds, that's much faster than the eyes blink. We have no option but to use technology, obviously. We don't have a choice. The business is such. But if you look on the trading side, the traders, the more savvy investors, it is still the traders who are using their strategies, which are being coded and put into these algos. So that's not being replaced. You still need those people with those strategies to put into those algos for them to execute. The speed of execution is much quicker. Maybe tomorrow they'll be more predictive in terms of the strategies that one can adopt based on the data real-time available. There are departments within the exchange like surveillance which are, you know, are using these technologies for looking at data real-time as the trades happen. Even the regulator is doing it, right? So on the technology side, all of this is here to stay. From an perspective that, you know, the job roles have become obsolete, I think, you know, for us in the exchange, we have never had so many people from the very beginning that anybody's role or elements of the role became obsolete. I think one of the challenges the exchange faced was having to teach everyone themselves, because there has been no formal education or course related to capital markets for a long time. Now we see few institutions offering maybe specializations like an MBA in capital market, financial market, also papers being taught, but I think, you know, from our perspective, it is not enough. As Piyush said, I think the standard answer that we give ourselves also is that let's take the guy on board, we'll teach him later. And we have no option because there is really nobody teaching these courses to the extent that we as a potential employer would like somebody to come on board. And the challenges that we face, because, you know, we still hire people irrespective of technology, we need people to look at those technologies, but we also need other people for human interaction, which is always there. You know, we are frontline business development professionals, or we are giving member services, or we are approaching the market for various reasons. So we are, within the exchange, you know, we have this huge human element to it, the one that interacts with the market. We have specifically specialized focused technology who do not interact with anybody, including within the exchange. They don't use mobile phones during the entire day. It's kept away on the trading floor. And yet there is a fair section, you know, on the regulatory side, which will push a lot of paper. So they do go out and inspect books of accounts, et cetera, of the brokers. So we have the entire flavor, the entire spectrum is available to us. But when we interview, and I personally interview, I think, on a daily basis, one thing I can't fathom is that while you may not have the requisite knowledge or the skill set today, is that you have come with your own wish list of what I want before discussing what you can offer us. You don't want to discuss in detail what the job role is. You do not wish to understand what career prospects our company holds for you. What is your growth? Where are you likely to grow in the next 3 years? But when I ask you that question, I would be in a decision-making stage. And I don't know how many multiples of that 3 years I took to reach some stage of my career with the receiver, I can actually take some decisions. And that is the reality. I think, you know, this managing expectations doesn't come when we are already in the workplace. I think this managing expectations should happen in the classroom. Because I sometimes really wonder, what is the, you know, frame of mind you're coming to the interview with? And then unfortunately, my interviews don't last more than 5 minutes because I don't do a technical interview. And I have candidates ask me, boss, you know, sir, you took just 3 minutes. I said, what do I measure from your CV? You have written what you have written. Some may be relevant, some may be irrelevant. I can't verify any of that. Right? So I'm seeking for two things. One is your aptitude, other is the attitude. And again, both of these points, I find it very, very difficult to measure or even identify in a lot of cases. So if you ask them to make some PPT, they will make a PPT, they present it to you, they'll be highly impressive. But I'm not sure why you want to do this job or why are you here for the interview? Is this something you're looking at really? Are you passionate about the subject or you're here because now the placement season is ending and you have nothing in hand? So I think I'm just trying to put forward a bit of a wish list. It's a few of the gaps that we see as a potential employer. I'm not sure how much can be addressed, but you know, we take interns every year. And recently we had three from a prestigious institute in Coimbatore. So obviously everybody comes that, you know, this is our institute's requirement. This is what we need to do in these 2 months. And you know, see, as an employer, we have no choice but to, you know, abide within the requirements of the institution. But, you know, being a sales guy all my life, I just put the shirt on the job, on sales. Understand the product, and please help us because what you need is fine, but we also need something at the end of the day. Okay, that's the reality. We have a resource for 2 months, we will utilize it. At the end of the 2 months, I asked, so, you know, kind of, did we meet your expectations? No, sir. So, I did not delve into what your expectations were because it doesn't matter now. But they did give feedback in the sense that, sir, we now realized how difficult sales is. This is something maybe we don't want to do. Sir, cold calling, sir, you know, we felt humiliated. You know, there are a large number of MBAs coming out every year. Every guy is not going to get those fat salaries that are published in the newspapers. Right? Everybody is not going to work for the big six or the other larger multinational banks or any other institution, right? So we will all have to find that fit between the employer and the employee at some stage. But coming with preconceived notions, having high expectations, an attitude which will irk the potential employer at the interview stage itself, is possibly something that can be worked upon in the classrooms itself. I think the internships, which are 1.5-2 months, I don't know how much it benefits the students. I'm definitely unsure about how it benefits the companies who are taking these people. If you could actually have an internship that runs for 6 months or so in parallel with the companies that they wish to join, which they should specifically say at the end of the year before they get into specialization. If they spend 6 months or more with us, we know who our future employees are, and they probably have a better understanding of what the job role is likely to be, and the nuances and the realities of what is going to hit when they join. Because it's not about the package being offered. So some people say, yeah, I want this much. And I'm saying, fine, I'll give it to you. But 6 months is what I'm also having with me to confirm your probation. And these are hard realities. So if you are going to come upfront, then I shall also be upfront and say, in 6 months, if you don't deliver what is expected, what is required, in terms of what I am going to pay you, I reserve the right not to confirm you. So things are getting very, very cutthroat. Employers as well as employees, potential employers, it's getting a bit scary. But that is because I think we're all moving towards candidates and possibly employers taking a hard stand. Because there are requirements from industry which possibly is not getting fulfilled. There are expectations of the candidates that are not getting met or even being moderated to a more realistic level. I think the soft skills, as Piyush mentioned, are a huge challenge today. They have to be better equipped in terms of handling even stress interviews. I remember when I joined HSBC way time back, I went through the famous elevator interview. And I was so upset. Because the guy just asked me which building I stay in, how many floors is the building, which floor do I stay on. And the interview started and I reached the 7th floor and I was asked to leave the room. If we do this today with our candidates, I am not sure in which spirit they're going to take this. And we talk about stress on the job. So and sometimes I prefer to test them before giving them the job. Can you take the stress of the interview itself? And sometimes, you know, we go, the feedback goes to the consultant. No, you know, in the interview, we felt like this or we got treated like this. I think it's best then, you know, you had the treatment then and not later. Because the bad hire is very expensive for us as well. And it costs you a fair bit of time on your career, right? So I think, you know, a lot of prestigious institutions are now focusing on industry interface. I would urge people sitting in this room to stretch it a bit in terms of amalgamating it for at least 6 months so that employers benefit and more importantly these students benefit, because today we seem to be asking the question, do we need MBAs or should we just take more experienced people from the market, right? And machines, etc., will be there. We need people to handle the machines. Humans are, after all, irrational, and that's a good thing for us, I guess. Thank you. Thank you.